Hi, my name is Chris, aka Vamfun on the robotic forums. I'm a mentor for Team 599 and Team 1508. Today we're at the home of 1508, which is Grant High School, out here in near Valley College in San Fernando Valley. We're going to talk about a robotic composter that was built by the Vex team as a spring project. And as an introduction, I want to show a little bit of the garden and where it's going to be. And so I'll have my cameraman pan around. And you can see the size of the garden. It has a lot of vegetables recently that have been worked on by the master gardeners. And over here, we have a lot of fruit trees that have been recently planted by the tree people. And here is the school. And the kids will be using this as a class learning environment. And they also work with caterpillars, as well as gardening and learning how to produce food and also cook it. Let's go over here and talk to Bettina. Bettina is one of the master gardeners and a member of the tree people that has volunteered her time. Can you tell us a little bit about what you're doing?
Yeah, I came in as a volunteer here, first with tree people, where they planted the orchard starting 2 years ago. And that was the first part of this project, coming in and working with the school and giving them a brand new orchard. In addition to the existing two or three citrus trees they have, now they have a whole orchard of stone fruit trees. This last year, I'm also a master gardener volunteer. A couple of us have been here, and what we're trying to do is build the soil using compost, which we had to have shipped in. And so we're really excited about the robotic composting program, because now we'll have compost on site and we won't have to depend on getting a truckload to come in at a time. So we do, what we've been doing is working on building these raised vegetable garden beds using a process called sheet mulching, which involves using compost, layers of straw. In our case, we're using the bunny bedding. Is it leftover bedding from a bunny rescue place that we pick up, and we pick it up in these big blue bags and we build these. What we're doing is improving the soil. So we're hoping that next year we're going to jump off and work with students and have the students more involved in this gardening project. So.
Well, that's great. It looks like you've got some wonderful harvest already.
Exactly. Before the students went off in off school in June, they helped us plant all these tomato plants. As you can see, we have an abundance of tomatoes. cucumbers, zucchini, other squash, pumpkins. We planted all that with the students this last. We started in December, and we did a little bit of winter gardening. And then come May, April, May, we were planting the summer garden. And what we're doing now is just harvesting a little bit of what the students worked on earlier in the year.
Great. Let's go over and look at what you've got going so far. We decided to do was house this in a butterfly complex, which we can lock up at night to make sure that it's not vandalized, because we do have a lot of things that kids like to maybe destroy.
Right.
But here's our sign that basically tells about who was involved. We had more than one club on the school. We had both the Vex Robotics team and the Roots and Shoots Club, which is an environmental club on campus. And they kind of came up with the idea, and they've turned it over to the Vex Robotics team to design and build and test. And we obtained a grant from ARC and the IEEE. Combined, IEEE gave us $1,000. And we didn't spend it all. I think we spent probably around 500 of it for actual construction and parts, and another couple hundred for extra tools that we needed as a team. The teacher here is Mushtaba Khan, and he's been our coach basically for the Vex team here, and I've been mentoring this team for probably 2-3 years now. Bettina, why don't you show us what you've got going here?
Okay, so compost, traditionally what you have to do is turn it by hand. So this is kind of an innovation that's going to speed up the process because it's robotic. It's going to do it automatically for us, so it's less work for the gardener.
Okay.
So the trick to building compost using the robotic composter or any compost system is you need two types of material. You need material that's high in carbon, which would be your dry stuff like leaves, in our case straw, bedding, bunny bedding. Put that in the compost pile, mixed in with high nitrogen, which would be your fresh green vegetables. So here we have some cabbage leaves, it looks like, and if you want to speed up the process a little, you can cut it up as you put it in. Smaller pieces will break down faster. So to build your compost, you put in a certain percentage of nitrogen, whatever you have in the garden. In our case at the moment, it's cabbage leaves and squash leaves. You close up your bin. Oh, a little bit of water. If it's really dry material, as you put it in there, every now and then you might need to water down your compost bin a bit. But since this is going to be automatically turning, it's really once we've filled it up and added a little bit of water, checked that the water moisture's in there, everything else is going to be automatic. There's no work on the gardener's part of having to shovel and turn it by hand. So this will take, hopefully, ideally, a slow compost pile could take years. If you just have a pile of leaves and you just put them in your garden, you wait for them to break down naturally. If you're turning your compost in the garden, it could be 2, 3, 6 months, depending on how diligent you are. We're hoping this will speed up the process and do it for us a lot quicker. So the machine will automatically turn. Once the compost is done, we'll open our trapdoor, face to the bottom, have a screen, sink it out into our wheelbarrow, and it'll go back into the garden to build the slab.
Show us how you operate this.
Once we've added whatever we're adding to our barrel, what we want to do is we want to come and turn the machine so it's on off so that we can automatically manually turn the barrels a couple of times. So we'll add it fresh water if we've just added compost. Just kind of stir it up a little bit. And then the important thing to remember is to put the machine back on auto because we have the solar panel up on the top of the cage. It automatically returns barrels 5 times a day. So at this point, my work is done.
Okay, this is Chris again. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the detailed construction and what went into making this thing operate. In order to do that, we've designed this composter so that these barrels can be removed if they want, and actually you can carry them to a garden and dump it there. But in general, we think the fact that we've raised it up high enough to get a wheelbarrow underneath, that these barrels will probably remain stationary. But I'll lift one off to show you it can be done. They weigh about 20 pounds without the compost, and maybe a compost adds another 50, 60 pounds. And these things can actually be rolled if you want, but I have a feeling the gardeners won't be doing much of that. Now that we've exposed it, you can kind of see how the mechanical drive is built. It's pretty simple. We have a steel axle that's a half an inch in diameter. It's held in place by bearings on each end and also a bearing in the middle. And these bearings are self-aligning bearings that were donated by Aegis, and they're actually made out of plastic, but they can hold several hundred pounds with no problem. We purchased these collars to hold the wheels on from a robotic site. They probably run about $30. The axle itself was probably around $30 with shipping. And we did some machining and put some 4-inch wheels on here, which is the diameter that we wanted. And these wheels have to create a tangential force equivalent to about 60 pounds per barrel. And so that creates a torque of about 120 pounds times a 2-inch moment arm. So we've got about 240 inch pounds of torque that are required to turn this steel axle. So over here, we have a little cog pulley mechanism that's driven by a Van Dorn motor. This is a Taijin motor that is used in FIRST Robotics. It has about 300 inch pounds of torque on the output shaft, and we have a 4-to-1 gearing ratio here with their cog-built drive. So, in general, we've designed it so that the motor itself is operating at about 20% of its maximum torque, and so it's operating pretty close to its maximum efficiency. It's a 12-volt motor, and it's driven by the electronics box, and we've designed it so that it can operate by itself without anybody using it for even without sun for maybe a period of 5 to 10 days. Without sun and with sun, it's easily charged up in maybe 1 or 2 days if you have a dead battery. I want to show you a little bit here. We had to add friction tape to the barrels because we need a coefficient of friction of at least 1/2, and these barrels are pretty slippery, and typically they run from 0.2 to 0.4 friction coefficient. And if we come over here, I will rotate this barrel, and I wanted to show you a quick look at the inside. Right here, if you can, if there's enough light, what we have is some bamboo that has been zip tied to the side of the barrel, and there's one on each half of the barrel, and that helps keep the compost from sliding and causes it to mix better. Ramin will get a good picture of these latches. These are kind of like suitcase latches. And so far they've been holding up, but we have to be careful to make sure that they don't come open when it's rotating. Okay, the frame itself, you can see, is built out of 2x4s. There's approximately, I think, a total of 5 8-foot 2x4s that have been cut up. And these are pressure-treated lumber so that they can withstand the outdoor environment without rotting. And that's about it. These wheels were purchased pretty cheaply from a surplus store. They're not free turning casters. They're just free. They're fixed axle casters. And originally, when we designed it, we had these wheels at about this level. And what we found is that the weight of the compost and was causing some dimpling when these sat for a while in the sun, because what happens is the HDPE plastic tends to soften a little bit as the temperature goes up, and this thing can be sitting in the sun and get probably 100, 120 degrees inside at least. So we solved the problem by moving the wheels to the outer rim here where it has a little bit more support, and that seemed to do it. So we're in business. And we'll now go to the electronics.
Hello, my name is Ramin. I was the captain of the Vex Robotics team at Grant High School this past year, and I've graduated. And I took the lead on the electronics part of this project. And basically the purpose of having a circuit running the project was that we wanted the motor to rotate the barrels for about 2 minutes every day, automatically, and therefore we had to have a timer on the charge controller and everything else I'll explain more in detail. So here we have an electronics box purchased from Osh, and it's got a ceiling, so meant to be waterproof. And we have holes, however, on all sides of the box, and therefore we have a spacer, so just in case if the water gets into the box, it wouldn't short the wires out. And here you see a solar charge controller, and this is a controller purchased from eBay for about $15, and it is necessary because we're running this circuit. I mean, the battery that we have here is charged up by a solar panel up there, and this is meant to promote the idea of environmentally friendly source of energy, and also the fact that it's self-sustainable. And we have a solar panel coming into the electronics box, this charge controller is between the panel and the battery and the timer. So the charge controller has basically two main functions. One function is the low voltage disconnect. Just in case if the battery's voltage drops below 11 volts, it will disconnect the circuit from the battery, so it wouldn't be drained anymore. And once it's fully charged to up to 14 volts, it will reconnect. And it also prevents the battery from overcharging.
We have a timer.
Also bought from eBay. It is. It can handle up to 5 amps, and it's an adjustable timer with increments of 1 minute, and we're just running it daily for 2 minutes, and you can set the time to start out at any time you want. So, because it's a low current timer, we have two car relays or 12 volt relays in the back. They are between the timer, the low current path and high current path, because the motor draws initially about 40 amps. That's the surge current of the motor. And therefore the timer can only handle about 5, so we have to have those relays in there. And the other piece that we have in there are the transient voltage suppressors that are across the coil and also the motor, and it basically suppresses the voltage on the open contacts due to back EMF. And we also have a PTC fuse just in case. And the wiring, most of the wiring pieces are from All Electronics. And that's the fuse right there. So for the high current path, we use the 14 gauge wire. And for the low current path, we use the 22 gauge. And we thought the spade connectors were convenient to use in this case, and we didn't do a lot of soldering, so it's a pretty neat so on. Here we have the control panel. One of the main design issues was to be user-friendly, and we've made it as simple as we possibly could. Here we have the auto switch. It either turns it on the auto mode or off. So once it turns once it's on the off position, we can manually use the switch. It's a spring return to center switch. And you can see that you can manually adjust the barrels using that. And once we're done, we have to set it on the on position or the auto mode, where the barrels would be automatically rotating daily and the switch would be inactive. So, and these are laminated sheets. And we also have the instructions on every side of the structure, caution signs.
Okay, and what did you learn in the project?
Well, I didn't know much about electronics and circuits, and this was one of the circuits that I got to learn a lot about. It was quite interesting. It took me about a month to put everything together and build it and mount it here. So it was a great learning experience for me this past spring to work with the other people and see this come alive.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Ramin.
Thanks.
Good job.
For more information about the detailed circuit diagram and everything else about the projects, as well as pictures and how we progressed, follow the links at the end of the video. Thank you.